I want to warn you now. Okay, the subject for today, when I say it, it may raise your eyebrows a little bit, but don't judge me until I explain. All right? Y'all hear me? All right. My subject for today is removing shit from your life. Not shift. Shit. From your life. Whoa, Reverend! You're cussing in the pulpit. No, I told you, don't judge me till I explain. Today the word is not a word. It's an acronym. S period H period I period T period. And each letter stands for the following: suppressive, harmful, intrusive thoughts. Okay? Removing shit from your life. Suppressive, harmful, intrusive thoughts. Does anybody have a Bible with them today? If you will, somebody get for me Philippians, the 4th chapter, the 8th verse. By the way, Minister Stewart is, I believe they're on their way back from Mississippi. As you know, they had a death in their family and they had to drive down for that, and the funeral was yesterday. So she sends her regards this morning. Pray for their safe trip back home. There's so much death taking place, man. Sometimes I sense it and I feel it, I see it coming. And I don't want to say anything because people say you're talking negative, but sometimes you just perceive things. You got it for me, Doc?
I got it, Doc.
Read it. What does it say? Yes.
Finally, brethren.
Whatsoever things are true,
whatsoever things are honest,
whatsoever things are honest,
whatsoever things are just,
whatsoever things are just,
whatsoever things are pure,
whatsoever things are pure,
whatsoever things are lovely,
whatsoever things are lovely,
whatsoever things are of good report.
Whatever those things are that are of good report.
If there be any virtue.
If there be any virtue.
And if there be any praise.
If there be any praise.
Think on these things.
Think on these things. Look at somebody and say, you ought to put your mind on a diet. Now I'm going to read that same passage for you from what is called the Message version. Here's what it says, and it connects the 9th verse with it as well. It says, friends, you will do best by filling your minds and meditating on things true, noble, reputable, authentic, compelling, gracious, the best, not the worst, the beautiful, not the ugly, things to praise, not things to curse. Put into practice what you have learned, what you heard, and what you saw and realized. Do that. Or do these things, and God, who makes everything work together, will work you into his most excellent harmonies. Now I want y'all to be sure you got that. What we just read is in essence saying, if you put your mind in the right frame of thought, it will produce certain results. A lot of times, you know, we give God credit for doing things when it's really, let's put it this way, follow me well. Some people think on first and second grade level. So because they think on first and second grade level, they have to say things that a first or second grader would process. For example, get ready for this now. In fact, everybody do this. Repeat after me. The space inside this circle,
represents my realm of knowledge.
All that I think I know,
about whatever I think I know,
is represented right here inside this circle. I must keep in mind that there is more to know than what is within the circumference of my awareness. Now, I just mentioned how some people think on a first and second grade level of thought. Some people think on a seventh, eighth grade level of thought. Some people think on 11th or 12th grade level of thought. And some people actually think on graduate level thinking. What's really deep is when you have all of those levels of thought in the same group of people. It can be very difficult sometimes trying to talk to those who are higher level thinkers without, you don't want to lose those who are lower level thinkers. And I don't mean that, I don't say that to put you down. Some people just have not developed, that's all. Because they still watch stuff like Empire. You follow what I'm saying? If loving you is wrong, the haves and the have-nots. You know, that's the most important event in their life during the week. Not reading a book. Not being still and giving some serious thought to some things, but allowing the idiot box to develop your lifestyle. Am I making sense so far? So when I say people have different levels of thought, we give God credit for things that God didn't do. And we blame the devil for stuff the devil didn't do. In other words, when good things happen in our lives, you know what we say God did it. When bad things happen in our lives, you know what we say the devil did it. It's like the man walked up and saw the devil in the corner crying one day. And he said, what's wrong? What's wrong? Why are you over here crying? He said, I'm tired of people blaming it on me. Devil did this, devil did that. No, I ain't do nothing. And now, let me break down what I'm getting ready to tell you. Like I said, when you put your mind in a certain frame of thought, it produces results. Whether it's negative results or whether it's positive results. Now, here's what you need to understand. It's not God or the devil doing it. It's the result or the fruit of the psychological and emotional seeds that you have sown. I'll never forget the day that we were standing out. There used to be this restaurant. I can't remember the name of it now. It's no longer there. But it's out by the Drury Inn. I think it's by the aircraft from the airport. I think there may be another restaurant there in place of it. At any rate, when I first came here, Minister Edwards and I went to this restaurant to get something to eat. And after we came out, we were just having a good discussion. And you know, of course, he was going to be one of my associate ministers here, blah, blah, blah. And I wanted to see where his head was and everything. So I wanted, because I wanted him to, be, if he's going to be one of my associate ministers, I wanted him on the same page with me. And so we're talking and everything, and he's talking, and, you know, he's talking about the Lord and da, 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 da. And so we got outside and I said, brother, I don't know if you ever thought about this or not, but I want you to understand something. God and the devil are one and the same. And it's deep because his knees buckled. And he had to grab the back of a car and hold on for balance. I said, are you all right, brother? He says, no, doc, I ain't all right.
No, what do you mean God and the devil are one and the same? I said, because we have been taught to think in an un-African perspective. We have been taught to think from a European perspective. And that has a lot to do with the way we were colonized. You see, y'all, long before we were even brought to this country, in slave ships. Now, a lot of us were here before the slave ships. Let's be clear on that. If you don't believe me, read They Came Before Columbus by Ivan Van Sertima. All right, and you'll see that we populated this country long before Christopher Columbus got lost. And notice I said he got lost. He didn't know where he was going. All right? Now, it's deep to understand this because from an African perspective, you think holistically, cyclical. You grab what I'm saying? So in other words, if you take your ring and look at it, it's one eternal circle. You can't tell where it starts and where it ends. Okay, because that's the cycle of life from an African perspective. Are y'all following what I'm saying? Okay, now as deep is because we were taught by Europeans, we think laterally. We think this way. We think it's either wrong or what? Right, yes. We think it's either good or what? Right, you got it. We think it's either up or what? Down. That's the way we've been taught to think. We've been taught to think in opposites or opposing energies or opposing forces. So what happens is we apply that same train of thought to when it comes to spiritual issues, when it comes to the Almighty. What would make you think that the God you serve is weak enough to have a fight with the devil? Think with me. Weren't you taught that God and the devil had a fight in heaven? Who in the world is awesome enough to have a fight with God? If your God has to have a battle with the devil, then it's not God. But we've been taught to think like that. How in the world, come on. How in the world can you even concern yourself with an entity that would war against God? That would even have a chance to war against God. So we need to get rid of that kind of thinking. And understand that energy, can I go here with y'all? Energy is energy. Now, the same energy can be positive or negative. Best way to look at it is look at it this way. Everybody say fire is good. Y'all believe that? Depends on how it's used, right? The same fire that will cook your food will burn your house down. It's not good fire and bad fire. Okay? It's the situation at the time that involves the fire. So once you come to the point of growing or developing or evolving to the point of understanding that everything that happens, I'll say it again, everything that happens is under the rule and thumb of Almighty God. Brother Ray, are you sure about that? Yes, because energy is energy. Now, what happens in your life is dependent upon where your head is at. Yes, sir. That's why I gave you this verse to open up with. Think on these things. Put your mind to work on positive things. Put your mind to work on good energy. Put your mind to work on things that are of good report. Some of us are so depraved in our thinking that all we do is feed into negative energy. So what we do is we suffer what's called what I refer to in this message, mind attacks. Write that down. A mind attack. Now it's important, brothers and sisters, that you understand what I'm talking about. Understand this. Your mind is the battleground for life or death. Hear me. Your mind is the battleground for life or death. And it's really interesting, y'all, because when the Europeans invaded our motherland and saw us doing what we do, it blew their mind.
Yes, sir.
It blew their mind, man, because we had the power of doing what they call supernatural things. Look at somebody and say, what's supernatural for the European is natural for us. How many of you guys have ever heard of the word metaphysics before? Let me see your hand if you've heard of metaphysics. All right. Metaphysics, you know, is a science that many of our people are trying to get into. Now listen to me very well, especially those of you who are watching this DVD. Metaphysics is a word that was coined by an imposter named Aristotle. In case you never heard of Aristotle before, he was a so-called Greek philosopher. Notice I said so-called. Aristotle, Plato, and what was the other one? Socrates. These so-called Greek philosophers, okay, got whatever knowledge they had from invading our motherland. And seeing the knowledge that was in the libraries of Alexandria and stealing that information and then applying what they saw, what they read, and claimed it as their own. And Aristotle came up with the word metaphysics. Meta meaning beyond, physics meaning the physical realm. Metaphysics. Now, why did he come up with the word metaphysics? Because he saw Africans doing what we do. He saw us knowing, follow this now, he saw us knowing what could not ordinarily be known. I lost y'all, didn't I? He saw us knowing what could not ordinarily be known. Now it's deep because they stole that and put it in the Bible and call it the word of knowledge as one of the gifts of the Spirit. In other words, the gifts of the Spirit that's recorded in the Bible, grab this now, is natural phenomena for us. Performing miracles, what the Europeans end up calling it magic. And because they saw us doing it, they called it black magic. Y'all ain't following me. They call it black magic, and then they turn around and demonized it because they didn't want us using it. Because they know that's our power. And then they confined us to the literature that they produced. Are y'all with me? They confined us to the literature that they produced. Y'all think let me prove my point to you. Somebody turned to Hebrews, the first chapter, the first verse. They actually tell you in their own literature the truth that they want to keep us from. Hebrews 1:1, I'm pretty sure that's the passage. Could be wrong, I'm just calling off the top, this is off the top of my head here. Hebrews 1:1, somebody get it, read it for me. What does it say? The first verse, Hebrews 1:1.
The Message Bible or?
Let's go, well you can read the Message Bible, let's see how it reads.
Going through a long line of prophets, God has been addressing our ancestors in different ways for centuries.
Stop, I need this to be heard. Stand up, brother, and face the audience as you read it. I like the way that reads. Good. Notice what it says. Now, listen carefully.
It says...
Now, before you read that, let me see if I can quote it correctly from the King James Version. King James Version says, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spoke to the prophets. Thank you. He spake in time past to the people by the prophets. Now, not understand what I'm saying. God, now this is what they wrote. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the people through the prophets. Okay, now let's read it in the Message version. Go ahead, brother.
It says, going through a long line of prophets.
Going through a long line of prophets.
God has been addressing our ancestors.
Uh-oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. God has been addressing who?
Our ancestors.
God has been addressing our ancestors. How?
In different ways for centuries.
In different ways for centuries. Does it list those ways there?
It says recently.
Okay, let me go, because another translation says, through dreams and visions and divinations. Y'all getting this? In other words, how many of you, now let's bring you into this here. How many of you, and if you've become very, 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 very deculturalized, then you have to maybe think back to your mother or your grandmother or your great-grandmother. But how many of you have experienced some of our people saying, the Lord showed me something in a dream? Y'all ever hear that before? I had a dream about a certain thing. Or, you know, I was standing and I was cleaning the house and I had a vision. The Lord showed me a vision. See, we don't have that stuff happening among us now. You know why? Because we've become so Euro-intellectualized that we've gotten away from who we are. But when we're tapped into our spirituality, okay, we can kind of, don't nothing catch us by surprise because we saw it in a dream. Or we had a premonition.
That's the Living Bible.
The Living Bible says it? Read it from there.
Long ago, God spoke in many different ways.
Stand up and turn around, brother, so everybody hear you.
Long ago. God spoke in many different ways.
God spoke in many different ways.
To our fathers. Through the prophets. In visions. Dreams. And even face to face. Telling them little by little about his plan.
Yes.
Thank you. Now it's really interesting. Because they wrote that.
Yeah.
Look at somebody next to you and say, Africans didn't write that. So who put that in the Bible? They did. The programmers, the controllers. And they told the truth. The only thing that they didn't tell the truth about, they said, our ancestors. Because it wasn't their ancestors. It was our ancestors. Are y'all following this? See, our ancestors had this, for lack of a better word, a direct pipeline with God. Why? Because we were in tune with nature.
Yes, sir.
We kept our mind on a diet. You got this?
Yeah.
There was no show called Power back then. There was no show called The Haves and the Have-Nots back then. See, we need to understand what this is really doing to us. We need to understand what television is doing to us. We need to understand what the media is doing to us, period. And put ourselves on a diet. So our people had a line of communication with the Almighty. And we understood from a holistic perspective how the mind of God worked. Now grab this, man. I hope this is making sense as I'm saying this to y'all. There's so much in here I want to share with you. We understood from a holistic perspective how the mind of God worked. But we didn't try to doctrinalize it. We didn't try to analyze how God works. We just understood God is. That's what we understood. You understand? In other words, when we saw a cloud in the sky, we didn't try to systematize why is that up there. We just respected the fact that it was. When the wind blew, we didn't try to create something called harp to control nature. We respected nature for what it was. There was nothing in us that gave us the desire to conquer nature. That's not African. But now we have African children going to school trying to learn how to conquer nature. Getting degrees in trying to conquer nature. Let's understand what mind attacks really are. You may want to write this down. A mind attack is the manipulation of supernatural energies and forces against someone. How many of you know, not believe, how many of you know that you are at war? You're at war. You are at war against energies that want to destroy you. You are at war against, the Bible actually says it this way, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, spiritual wickedness in high places. Not when it says high places, it literally means in the ethereal realm. Spiritual wickedness, that those are the opposing forces to keep you from wearing a smile on your face. So a mind attack is a manipulation of supernatural energies. Again, brothers and sisters, please don't make the mistake of thinking I'm getting ready to go metaphysics on you. Now, I'm not knocking metaphysics. I want you to understand what metaphysics is. Metaphysics is a Greek's description of our African spirituality. Did y'all get what I just said? See, in other words, for me to even say I'm going to get into metaphysics means I'm disrespecting what's natural for me. Why? Because metaphysics is not our description. That's Aristotle's way of describing what's natural for African people. Y'all getting this? So my thing is, let's return to who we are. You don't have to go sit up in a class and try to learn who we are from those who are not us. Y'all missed that one. You have to sit up in a class and try to learn about us from people who are not us. They studied us. They watched us. They watched our rituals. Are y'all getting this? They documented what they saw. I was talking to a sister just yesterday trying to explain to her the phenomena of speaking in tongues. I said, sister, what you talk about is not biblical. She said, but I've spoken in tongues. I said, I have too. Randa de boho shakana sihe. She said, well, you can do that, Dr. Higgins. I said, I grew up in a Pentecostal church. Of course I can do it. You get what I'm saying? Your culture, your environment has a lot to do with influencing your ability to do things. If you grew up around a thing, you can do it. Real simple. It's just like the preacher who says, he can do that because he can sing. Preachers who can't sing can't do that. those. It has to do with your skill and your talent and your ability. Am I making sense to you? So stop being hoodwinked, making you think something is deep and spiritual when it's not. Oh, wow. Woo, you hear that? Woo, man. People fall for that hype. Let's understand how your mind is the battlefield here. Because if the spirit of deception can grab your mind, it has you. Guess what else, y'all? If the spirit of truth gets a hold of your mind, it has you. Now, how does mind attacks work? How do they work? Mind attacks occur when negative energy vibrations are sent from one person or one individual to another individual or to another place, creating disturbances in the energetic and physical bodies of the person or place. Now, I want y'all to think back with me for a moment, because see, some of us are so busy that we are encountering mind attacks and don't even realize it. So slow your roll for a minute and think with me. How many of you have ever met someone, maybe in the last week, maybe just yesterday? How many of you have actually met somebody, and when you met them, you knew something wasn't right? They didn't even have to open their mouth. Their energy was just so raw. Their energy was just so negative. You want to say, I wish I hadn't even came in here and met you. You follow what I'm saying? Because what you're getting from that person is just straight negative energy. Well, there are some people who honestly transmit their energy to other people on purpose. What I'm saying ain't new. My great-grandmother used to say it this way. This was her way of describing it. Baby, don't you understand that misery? See, y'all got it. Misery loves company. So you get around a person who's miserable, unhappy, the corners of their mouth go down, and they frown all the time. And when you ask them, how you doing? They live in a negative atmosphere. When you encounter people like that, you got to be one of two things. You got to have enough sense to get away from them, or you better be mighty strong yourself, because they will absorb your positive energy and you'll walk out weak. Trust me, man. One of the things I used to do is I used to service funeral homes in New Jersey. And it blew my, y'all, I'm not, I remember I got to the place, I was doing like 5, 6, 7 funerals a day. And I couldn't figure out for the life of me, I would start like maybe 9 or 10 o'clock in the morning and go through to like 3, 4 in the afternoon. And I couldn't figure out for the life of me why at 5 o'clock I was no good. I mean, I was actually weak. And after a while it dawned on me, this spirit of bereavement, the negative energy of people who are grieving, was actually sapping my energy from me. Y'all understand what I'm saying? That's one of the reasons, y'all, why I'm not crazy about going to hospitals. Because it's sickness, it's disease, it's negative energy in hospitals. It's negative energy in funeral homes. And you have to get to the point of knowing yourself well enough to guarding your space, guarding your energy, even if it's not in a hospital, It might be sitting up here in the African Village. Yeah, I said it. You may come in here all happy. Woo! Hey, y'all, what's happening? My auto tip. And then you greet one person and shake their hand, or two or three people. And after all, your motto tip is like, my auto tip. Well, let me hear him get up out of here. Because you ran into negative energy. You have to get to the point to where you learn to recognize it when you see it. Now, let me go back to some of my upbringing here and show you how these Christians, if you don't mind my saying this, these Christians who were tapped into spirit could identify the very thing I'm talking about. We had one brother in our church, old elder, and he'd run into negative energy in the church, and he would say, loose here, loose, loose. Now, of course, when we're little boys, we know what he's talking about. But he was talking about, loose that negative hold here. Some would say, I rebuke you. Satan, the Lord, rebuke you. Because they're feeling that negative energy. I rebuke that spirit. Mm-mm. No. Some would say, get up out of here, Satan. You ain't got no room in here. You see how they would talk to that energy? That was just their way of talking to that energy. That's all. Okay, now we sit up here with it. Sit up here right next to it. Yeah. And sometimes I say, turn to somebody next to you and say such and such. And what you need to be saying is you need to get up out of here. Yeah. Because see, listen, if you don't address that negative energy in your space, it will become your space. Are y'all getting what I'm saying? And you have to protect you. You have to protect your space. You have to protect your space and not allow others' negative energy to intrude upon it and steal your joy. Look at somebody and say, don't let nobody steal your gusto. Y'all get that? Negative energy, the older folk used to call it a spirit. But I'm not going to use the word spirit. Because see, when I say spirit, we get Catholic on that. Then we start thinking the exorcists. And demons and demonic possession and all that kind of stuff. And folks say, you know, you are not to let a lot of demons up in there. Cast them demons out. You know, hear me well. The only demon is in your mind. Did y'all hear what I just said? Okay, the only demon is in your mind. Now, I know a lot of us have been so influenced by Catholicism that we honestly believe that you can, there are demons roaming around and sitting up in folk in church, and you got folk from the background. I came from Pentecostal church. They used to look like to go around and lay hands on folk and cast the devil out of folk. Boom, you know. And one day I challenged this preacher because he was known for that. He wanted to come in and just cast demons out of everybody. And I said, wait a minute. Now, according to the Bible, when you cast a demon out of somebody, they got to go somewhere, right? He said, that's right. I said, so why are you so anxious to cast demons out of people with all these children sitting up in here? Right? Shouldn't we protect the children? And of course, that kind of stumped him, and he didn't have no answer for that. But common sense said, if this demon's coming out of this person, they want to find somebody else to go into. So why don't you just leave it in that person? Just leave him right where he is. Okay, just leave the demon right there and let that one person be messed up. Okay, ain't that common sense? Okay, if the demon is in that one person, then leave that one person alone. Okay, sit him in the back somewhere. Then your ego get involved in this because you want to impress people with your power. Cast the demons out of that one person. Now that one person's all right and five other people messed up. So I won't call it a spirit, negative energy, especially being a mind physician. I want to call it a psychological disposition. That's what I want to call it. That negative energy is a psychological disposition that you encounter in other people. And stop being a punk when you encounter a negative psychological disposition in other people. Address it. If it's no more than, say, like the old folk used to say, I don't like your spirit. That's how they used to say it. They weren't saying I don't like a demon in you. They were saying I don't like your psychological disposition. I don't like your countenance. I don't like what I'm getting from you right now. And learn how to, man, you got to learn how to speak to this stuff. Don't be a coward. Don't cower down and let it invade your sacred space. Listen, y'all, everybody do this right here. Everybody say this. Put your hand on front of you like this. And then and just kind of go around yourself. Say, this is my sacred space. Understand that. You know, in this space right here, there's something called your aura. A-U-R-A. Your aura. That's your energy glow. Got me? And nothing should interfere with your aura. Let me tell you why. Because your aura is your exterior energy glow, and nothing can get to you without first going through your aura. Is this making sense? And if you allow it to contaminate your aura, see, as long as your aura is strong, you're going to be healthy. As long as your aura is strong, you're going to stand tall. You're going to be strong. You're going to be grounded. You're going to be rooted. As long as your aura is strong. But once you allow your aura to be attacked, then you become defenseless. That's when stuff starts happening in your world. Start happening in your life because you allowed a vampire in. Now, I don't know if y'all know the mythology behind vampires. Y'all know what a vampire is though, right? Basically, you know, from watching television, Dracula and all that kind of stuff. Okay, well, let me tell you, vampires are real. Not the ones you watched on television. Not the ones that turn into a bat, no. I'm talking about blood suckers. I'm talking about energy suckers. They want to sink their fangs into you because you got something going on in your life. There's something positive about you. You're moving on. You're flowing with the wind. And those who are not moving on get envious. Get jealous. And because they're not doing anything, they're not progressing, they want to stop you from progressing. You know why? Because misery loves company. So they want to sink their fangs into you and make you like them. So you become the walking dead or the walking undead. Is this making sense? So you have to protect yourself. Now, how do you protect yourself from vampires? With a cross. And by the way, in the story of a vampire, if you remember, a vampire can't come in your house. Who knows the rest of that? Thank you, brother. Unless you invite them in. That's the same thing in real life, y'all. The vampires can't come and take your energy unless you give them permission. Okay, so you have to learn to see beyond the cologne. You got to learn to see beyond the hairstyle. You got to learn to see beyond the hips. Brothers? Y'all all right? You got to learn to see. Everybody say, I have to learn how to see the reality behind the appearance. See, we get starstruck by what our eyes see. Close your doggone eyes. Close them eyes and open that third eye and learn how to see. Really, sometimes I wonder if we would really have a problem with our vision if our sisters didn't put on so much
mask
to make themselves look such a certain way? What if they just came out the house like they woke up? We'd have a whole lot more holy folk, wouldn't we? And same thing with the brothers. You know, we suit down, put on certain oil or whatever, make sure our shoes are shined. And, you know, a few weeks ago I met a sister, and she looked at my feet. She said, "I can tell what kind of man you are because your shoes are shining." I said, "Is that all it takes to get you is shine shoes?" That's what I was telling you. Know, I was very serious about that because she summed up my entire character based on how my shoes look. You know?
Keep those shoes.
Keep them shoes on. I saw this movie the other day called The Perfect Guy. Sisters, if y'all haven't seen it, you need to see that. We are people of the earth. We are people of the planet. I want to give you a homework assignment because I'm running out of time. I want y'all to start at least 2 or 3 days a week walking on the earth with your bare feet.
Yes.
Okay? Well, Brother Ray, why you want me to walk out? No, well, find a good place that's where, you know, like at a nice park where the grass is not contaminated with broken glass and all that kind of stuff. You know, find a very nice area and just walk and let your feet connect with the earth. Everybody write this down. So that's called grounding yourself. You see, some of us are operating in such a high contaminated frequency that we need to be grounded.
Right.
Just like an electrical cord, you know, the 3-prong electrical cords that go into the wall, and the one at the bottom is for grounding. Okay? You know, if you're not grounded, and I don't know if you notice this or not, but I do a lot of broadcasting and stuff, when I have a cable that's not grounded, I hear a hum, a power hum. And it because it's not grounded properly. A lot of us are walking around with that negative energy hum. And it's deep because you don't see it. Other people see it. Okay? But you're walking around with a negative energy hum. So start grounding yourself. Okay? Understand that the mind attacks that you go through is the manipulation and movement of different types of energies because they want to transfer these negative energies into your space. That's why your mind is being attacked with thoughts. How do you attack the mind? With thoughts. Trying to make you think a certain way. That's why, again, I open up today with the passage, think on these things. Think on things that are pure. If you start entertaining thoughts that are not of good report, that are not pure, that are not honest, get rid of that mess. Put it out of your mind. Just like somebody comes into your house and don't know how to act, what do you do to them? Say, sorry, dude, you got to get up out of here. You got to go. You can't stay in here acting like that. Well, guess what, y'all? Your mind is more valuable than your apartment. Your mind is more valuable than your home. Your mind is the seat of your behavior. If an entity or an energy can take control of your thoughts and your mind and make you behave a certain way, hey, man, only you can stop that. Only you can stop that. As I said, it's difficult for an energy, a negative energy, to penetrate an aura that is healthy and strong. So write this down too. I must protect my aura. I must protect. See, brothers and sisters, ain't nobody gonna do this but you. Don't look for Brother Ray to protect your aura. I can't do that. I got my own aura to protect. And then after dealing with a good 15 or 20 y'all, my aura really needs some help. See, that's the deep thing about people in my position. See, now, unless you're in a managerial position on your job where you got to supervise a lot of people or something like that, you don't have a lot of auras to deal with but your own. Maybe your children, you know, if you live alone, you got it going on. Because, you know, ain't nobody else in or in your house but you, okay? But when you're in a capacity of leading people or standing before people or being a spiritual teacher or guide to people, you got to deal with all these energies and all these auras. And it's deep because I can feel the auras attacking me, and it's real as deep as when I feel them attacking me, I still got to do this. What do I want to say? You grab what I'm saying? Because you are feeding from my aura. So I have to be sure that, you know, my aura stays a certain way, and not just me, anybody in my capacity. We have to be sure that our aura stays a certain way. Some of y'all on your job, you ain't even trying to keep your aura up. You let her come over here. You let her come over here. She better not come over here. See, you done already put yourself in war mode instead of healing mode. Learn how to deal with those energies. Because see, they don't even have to come to you. You just see them. Oh, okay, I got to go here. Somebody needs what I'm about to say. They don't even have to say anything to you. You just see them, and you automatically put your aura on her or his level. You were doing fine just singing. Ain't no stopping it now. We're on the move. And you see. What's she doing here? You grab what I'm saying? We have to raise our vibration better than that, man. Okay? I had I told I was going to speak on this, and I forgot about it the other day, so I'm going to mention it now. One of our speakers in the conference we just had, a friend of hers came to hear her speak last weekend. But her friend was a European. Her friend was white. Right? And I don't know who it was. She didn't tell me who it was. She couldn't identify the person. But the white lady came to the door and left. And she told her friend, Sister Evangelist Anderson, I left because this lady there saw me and said, what's she doing here? You follow what I'm saying? In other words, just the sight of a white person made you lower your vibration like that. Look at somebody next to you and say, we can't allow white folk or Chinese folk and especially other black folk to make us lower our energy. Just because you see somebody, you know, don't all of a sudden let them pull you down to where you think they are. How you say it, Rich? I'm maintaining. Maintain, man. Maintain where you are. And come to grips with the reality. Can I go here? Since I've touched on that. Come to grips with the reality that you ain't in this world by yourself. I know you. It would be nice if we were, but we're not. I may have shared this analogy with you before, and I'll share it with you again. So you grab this. I want y'all to start seeing the world as an orchestra. Get this now. Now, I don't know how many of you know much about an orchestra, so let me help you with it. In an orchestra, you have different kinds of instruments. In an orchestra, you have what's called the woodwind section. You have the little flutes. Then you have the brass. The trumpets, real loud. Da 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 da. Then you have the string section. Okay. Then you have the percussion, the timpanis, boom 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 boom. And then the cymbals, crash crash. You have all of these different instruments in an orchestra. Saxophones, clarinets. Am I making sense here? Now, what you have to understand is this. Don't get upset because the other section is in the orchestra. I like to use us, I like to say we're the brass section. You know why I say we're the brass section? Because the brass section is the loudest section in the orchestra. And we make a lot of noise. Okay? So I call us African people the brass section. Now you know what my job is? My job is to be sure that the brass, the horns, are playing their part correctly. Did that make sense, y'all? That's my assignment. My assignment is to make sure that my section got our music right. My job is not to tell the string section, y'all don't belong here. My job is not to tell the woodwinds, y'all don't know how to make good music. My job is not to tell any other section that you don't belong in this orchestra. You know why? Because I did not build the orchestra. God built the orchestra. Are y'all getting this? And every section of the orchestra was put there by the orchestrator.
Yes.
But my job is to be sure that my section is playing our part right.
Yes.
Okay? Oh man, I got so much here to say and I'm... Let's deal with negative thought form. Egregore. How many remember what that word means? An egregore. If you do not know what an egregore is, please raise your hand. Okay, write this down, please. E-G-R-E-G-O-R-E. Now, let me take my time and deal with this because it's very important. An egregore. Now, and you don't take my word for it, you can Google it while I'm saying it, okay, if you got a smartphone. An egregore is the manifestation of a thought form. The manifestation of a thought form. In other words, you are having a thought about whatever, and you put so much energy into that thought until it manifests. And it becomes your reality. Did y'all get what I just said? Now, notice what I said. You heard that part, right, Graydon? It becomes your reality. It doesn't mean it's real. It's just real to you. Because it's in your head, and you put so much attention and energy into what's in your head till it becomes real. For example, let me give you an example. And I grew up watching egregores. I grew up watching so many egregores, I just didn't know they were egregores. I thought it was actually God at work. Here we go. Imagine this in your mind. I'm getting ready to call a prayer line. Okay, and I'm telling y'all now, in 3 minutes, I'm going to call a very special prayer line. Now, what did I just do? Thank you, brother. By letting you know in 3 minutes, I'm getting ready to do something. Already, I done started hypnotizing you to the egregore. Then I come down on the floor and I say, all right, whoever wants special prayer, everybody say, what is special prayer? But how many of y'all have ever heard that phrase before? Come on, be honest. Yes. So I come down on the floor and I say, whoever wants special prayer? Well, of course, everybody wants special prayer. So that's trick number two in the psychology here. I'm really hypnotizing the hell out of you at this point. Special prayer. So now you stand up and you come down the aisle for special prayer. Now when you get down to me, I'm letting y'all know while y'all standing there, God is getting ready to do something awesome in this place. Follow the, y'all see this? See what's happening? God is getting ready to do something awesome up in here. Look at your neighbor and say, God is getting ready to do something awesome to me here. And you, now mind you, the energy, the atmosphere is like, whew. Then I say, and when I count to three, y'all standing in this line here, when you get to me, when I count to three, Something's going to touch you in the top of your head and go all the way to the crown of your feet. Now, all this is going on in your head. Are y'all seeing this? Okay. I've already hypnotized you. And then you helped me out by hypnotizing yourself, too. So you come up and you get to me and I say, one! Ah! Yeah. Two! Ah! And then when I say three and hit you in the top of your head, what happens? What happens? Sister said you fall out, right? You just fall right on the floor, right? Yes. You know why? Because I developed an egregore in your mind. Now, the deep thing about it is this goes on all the time, especially in religious settings. But we don't know that because we don't know what an egregore is. An egregore is when you believe something in your mind strong and long enough to where it produces results. And then because you don't know what an egregore is, guess what you tell folk? Oh, the Lord knocked me out today, child. Woo! I know it was God. Y'all see what I'm saying? Well, negative thought forms is something, or thought form period, is something that can be sent to others by an individual. And you need to understand this. So learn how to protect your mind. See, some of y'all, do y'all understand why I give you the frankincense and myrrh at the end of the fellowship? Some people think it's just something that we do. I don't want y'all to stop thinking that. Okay? It's actually, in fact, did you burn some of the data? Yeah. I told them, start burning frankincense and myrrh. Because fragrance has a lot to do with energies. Follow me well. How many of y'all have been around a person who didn't smell good? Come on now, be honest. You walked up to that, or you embraced that person, you know, and they didn't bathe in a few days, or they didn't brush their teeth, they didn't use, you know, and when you walked up to them like, oh, so good to see you, blah, 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 blah. And then when you hugged them, that fragrance that you got, you immediately everything went negative, didn't it? You said, you hugged them, you said, ooh. And it was deep as when you try not to show them that, yeah. You know, it's like, All right, brother. All right. Okay. Negative thinking such as anger, jealousy, animosity, seeking revenge, vindictiveness, all of these are thought forms. And they can be lodged in a person's mind. Of course, if it's lodged in your mind, it's going to be manifested in your body. Do you not know, brothers and sisters, and follow me well, a lot of your physical conditions are connected to what's going on in your head. A lot of people are sick because of sick thoughts going around in their mind. And you need to get that mess out of your head, man. How do you pick up negative energy from others? How do you do that? They're drawn to us. You're like a magnet. You can pick these things up at meetings, getting around people. Like I said, if you're not careful, you can pick them up when you come into the village. That's why it's important, man, to make sure you're in the right frame of mind when you come here. Okay? Because trust me, if it's negative energy sitting up in here, it make other folk not want to come back. You know, I mean, how many times have you seen people come here and they say, "Ooh, I really enjoyed myself," but they don't come back? When a person has suffered prolonged pain long enough in a certain place, the energies of that pain can remain there even though the person has left the place. I don't know if you guys remember when we had a court situation here and we finally won that court case. Those of us who are still here, they came in here and washed this entire building down. Because even though the people were gone, the negative energy was still here. The negative energy was so strong in here at one point, y'all, I used to preach looking over here. I wouldn't even look to that side of the church. I don't look right over here. Because the whole group of negative energy was sitting over here. And it was affecting me just that much. You see what I'm saying? Now I can look over here. I don't see a lot of people over here. But I mean, I see this big open space here, but those who are sitting here, I can look at you and feel good because it's a whole different energy level. You pick up negative energies because you absorb them. You are like a sponge spiritually. And I can't stress this enough, man. Protect yourself. Protect yourself. Protect your aura. Protect your energy field. That's why I do the frankincense and myrrh, because that is a form of cleansing, because it's a beautiful fragrance. And it is a fragrance that our people have used for thousands of years to dispel negative energy fields. Now, next time I give you frankincense and myrrh, I hope you'll understand it from that perspective. And that's why I said, take it, rub your hands together, just anoint yourself with it, because you're helping to replenish your aura with a sweet-smelling fragrance. If you notice, nobody ever puts Lindberger cheese on it. Y'all know what Lindberger cheese is? Why not? It stinks, exactly. You don't want that energy around you. Guess what? There's another area too. I got to touch on this because it's a part of this teaching. Everybody say sex and negative energy. Now I know for some folk that's kind of hard to grab. You know, just some folk just can't figure out how can something so good be so negative? Trust me, brothers and sisters, sex can carry negative energy with it. Hear me. It's important to start looking at sex. Now, don't y'all get real deep on me like you don't know what I'm talking about. Start looking at sex as an energy exchange. If you look at it as an energy exchange and not just physiological gratification, you'll be more careful as to who you allow yourself to engage with. See, the deep thing about the sex energy for the female especially, grab me, sisters, let me go here with y'all. I got some young sisters here, so I really want them to hear what I'm about to say. God wired y'all in a very, very strange kind of a way, sisters. God wired y'all to whereas once you engage in sexual activity with a person, you begin to acclimate to that brother. And notice I said brother. I say it again, brother. Do I need to say it one more time? Yeah, okay. To that brother, okay? You begin to acclimate to that brother. Now, the analogy I like to use to help our sisters understand what I'm talking about is, let's make believe, let's use the letters of the alphabet here. Okay? Let's say, sister, that you are sexually involved with a dude who has the character shape of the letter A of the alphabet. Because God wired you to acclimate to that brother, and it's deep because God did not wire the brother to acclimate to the sister. Isn't that deep? Sisters, you acclimate to the brother, but the brothers don't acclimate to you. And the reason for that is because if the brothers did acclimate to you, especially if it's a wonderful experience, he wouldn't get nothing done. He won't go out and work. He won't build the community. He won't provide for the family. Because all he want to do is he'll be an addict. Are y'all getting what I'm saying? So God didn't wire us that way. But God wired the woman to acclimate to the brother. In other words, you begin to take on his ways. You begin to take on his character. You begin to take on his countenance. You begin to know what he likes. Even more than he knows what he likes. Because that's the way God designed you. God wired you like that, women. Okay? I mean, you almost know what he's thinking before he thinks it. The longer you're with this guy. Am I making sense? What's really deep is the longer you're with him, the more you start becoming him. Okay? Because you're absorbing his biology. Okay? So his biological makeup, his DNA, his cells is becoming a part of your fingernails. It's becoming a part of your hair. I'm not too deep now, am I? Am I all right here? Okay? I mean, you actually... If you're with him long enough, you can actually smell your skin and smell him coming through your pores. Because God wired you like that. See, when the sexual act is over for the man, he washes you off. Are y'all getting this? He washes you off, but you absorb him. So let's say this guy you're with is shaped like the letter A in his character. And after you're with him for about a year or two or 3 years, whatever, however long, and you've acclimated, and then the relationship doesn't work. So guess what happens? You meet another guy. Right? But he's shaped like the letter E. And then you go through the same thing again. Right? And after another year or two and that relationship doesn't work, and you can go through the whole alphabet if you want to. Okay, then you meet a guy and he's shaped like the letter M. Then you meet a brother who's shaped like the letter T. Then W. And then X, Y, Z, depends on how many guys you go through. Imagine what's deep about this is when you leave one relationship, sister, the remnants of that alphabet is still there. Are y'all hearing this? I don't know why I'm on this right now, because it's definitely in my notes. But it's the remnants of that alphabet is still there. So by the time you go through several alphabets, you have a misformed, emotionally jacked up person, regardless of how you look on the outside. So you have to understand that these are energies, man, that get in your viscera. And you have to dispel these energies. You have to cleanse yourself from these energies, but a lot of times we don't allow that to happen because we don't give ourselves time to heal. Okay, I better move on. So here's how we do this. If you feel as you've absorbed some negative energy, the first thing you need to do is ask a spiritual advisor. It could be your spiritual teacher, your pastor, you know, a friend that you know is spiritual. The Bible actually speaks to this in Galatians, the 6th chapter, the 1st verse. I believe it's there. It says these words, "Brethren, if you see somebody overtaken in a fault, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, and don't forget that you can be tricked too." Are y'all getting this? In other words, the context here is if you're not careful to protect your space, the best of us can be overtaken in a fall. Did you get what I just said? The best of us can be overtaken in a fall. Man, let me close this thing. I've been going. It gets good to me now. A little bit of Dr. J rubbed off on me, y'all. I sent Dr. J 3 messages saying you got 15 minutes. over a course of 45 minutes. And at the last one, he just said, I'm going to ignore Brother Ray. He's sending me these messages. Because the man had so much to say, I understand. You see, there's always a strong need to protect those who have been invaded. Okay? And we need to come to grips with the reality that we have been invaded. And you may be invaded again. Just because you're hearing this message today doesn't mean you're going to walk out of here impervious to invasion. Okay, please don't make that mistake of thinking that. So one of the things to help protect yourself is through a thing called smudging. Now, a lot of people think that the only thing to smudge with is sage. Have y'all ever heard this before? Never heard about smudging with sage? Okay, smudging with sage is a Native American practice. Smudging with sage is not an African practice. Now, smudging is an African practice. But we didn't use sage. Native Americans use sage. And I look at so many of our people talking, we got to smudge and think they just got to use sage. That comes from a Native American practice. We have always smudged with frankincense and myrrh. Smudging, again, is when you take positive fragrances and dispel the negative energy with that fragrance. That's why I got them burning frankincense and myrrh in here. I don't know if y'all can smell it when you come in. You see what I'm saying? And it's a beautiful thing when you walk into an atmosphere and you smell a beautiful fragrance. It puts you in a certain mindset. You know, what would you do if you walked in here and smelled old food? You would say, something wrong up in here. Same thing with the right fragrance. It puts you in a certain mindset. Okay? So it's important to clear yourself. Everybody say this.
Every day.
I must make time to clear myself. Think about what I'm saying, family. Every day I must make time to clear myself. And the reason for that is because we are surrounded with so much negative stuff going on. Every time you turn around, man, somebody getting shot and killed. Every time you turn around, some other tragedy is taking place. Some other tragedy. You got to get to the place, y'all, and it's not that you don't care. You just got to protect your space. You got to get to the place of turning that stuff off sometimes. Just turn the news off. Boom. Now, some people are so nosy that they got to know what's going on. And because you're nosy like that, guess what? You have all this negative energy in your environment. You follow what I'm saying? Turn that mess off. Learn how to get the shit out of your life. You all right? You forgot what it meant? Suppressive, harmful, invasive thoughts. Write it down, please. I can't wait till I do this DVD cover. Suppressive, harmful, invasive thoughts. Those four letters spell a word. Get it out of your life, man. I told you about grounding. I close on this note. The important thing about getting this negative energy out of your life is you must be fully present in the moment. Write that down, please. You must be fully present in the moment. In other words, right now, right here, where I am, I'm not going to think about anything else but right here, right now, where I am. And make it what you want it to be. If you are in your present moment and you're thinking about what somebody did to you last week, you're not in your present moment, you're in the past. If you're in your present moment and you're worried about what's going to happen to you on tomorrow, you're not in that present moment. You're in the future. And brothers and sisters, you need to hurry up and learn that there's two things that you can do absolutely nothing about. And that's yesterday and tomorrow. Yesterday is full of its disappointments, heartbreaks, and all that kind of stuff, scars and memories, good and bad. Ain't nothing you can do to unscramble that egg. It's gone. Tomorrow, with all of its hopes, aspirations, dreams, ideas, all that's well and good. Okay? But tomorrow ain't here. The only thing that you have right now, as Luther said, is here and now. Here and now. That's all you have right now, man. Okay? Don't be like the man who spent his whole life worried about the day he was going to die. See, church will do that to you. Church will make you worry about, you know, I'm coming up on the rough side of the mountain. I'm doing my best to make it in. Which means you don't know if you made it or not. Don't live like that, man. Don't live like that. Clear your space. Be in the present moment. And have a and don't forget to pray. Gotta say that to you. I know a lot of us have gotten so intellectual now, especially with so-called consciousness, that we think, in fact, some people actually say prayer is a form of begging. That's their opinion. That's not my thesis. To me, prayer is communing with the Almighty. That's what it is for me. Okay? When I talk to God, and I don't have to have a posture to do it either. I don't have to stand like this. I don't have to get on my knees. I saw a cartoon the other, and I don't know if y'all knew about this, but I saw a cartoon that said the three major world religions all pray in three different positions. The Muslims look up. No, I'm sorry, I got that wrong. The Christians look up. The Muslims look down, and the Jews look at a wall. Which direction is God? Is God up? Is Christians, oh Lord, or the Muslims look down, or do the Jews who just stand in front of a wall, praying to a brick wall? None of them are important. What's important is that the condition and position of your heart and your mind is where it is. I found out, y'all, you can have, listen, I don't mean to sound vulgar, but some of my best prayer meetings have been in the bathroom. Yeah. You know, I said, I'm a whole different mode then, man. I'm not in a hurry to go nowhere. Just take my time and talk to God until you feel God move. Get rid of the fear in your life. Learn to breathe. Surround yourself in truth and think on those things. Okay? Remove the suppressed thoughts from your life. Remove the harmful thoughts from your life. Remove the intrusive thoughts from your life. Okay, so you can live your life. And don't let nobody bring you down, man. Ashe?
Ashe.
Ashe. All right.